Hey everyone, welcome back to Self Care Haven. You are listening to Emotional Abuse 101, a podcast designed to help survivors stage their own recovery from abuse and also to recognize the covert manipulation tactics that abusers use. Today I'm going to be going a little bit off topic and talking more about toxic friendships. I know we've talked a lot about toxic romantic relationship partners. But friends are very, very important to a survivor's recovery because they serve as a main support network for that survivor. Now, of course, during this time, you should also be seeking alternative support communities with people who've actually been there, who've been through your experience and really know what it's about. And for that, I recommend forums such as Psychopath Free. Let Me Reach by Kim Saeed is a very amazing community, as well as Lisa E. Scott's blog, which also has a forum on narcissistic abuse. But when we think about the people we interact with on a daily basis, a weekly basis, our friends, our close acquaintances, what have you, and their reactions to what we've gone through can really shape our recovery. Of course, we don't have to let it affect us as much, but as a society, we've stigmatized abuse survivors to such an extent that any source of support is really helpful to an abuser survivor's need for close relationships, need to bond after the abuse, need to feel positively regarded, and their desires to feel validated and supported through one of the hardest times in their life. So if you're surrounding yourself with people who are very invalidating towards your experience, and this could be a number of things that they do, they might engage in victim blaming, where they, instead of focusing on the trauma of the abuse, instead of focusing on what needs to be done for you to heal, they focus more on, well, why didn't you just leave? Or why didn't you leave sooner? Or I don't know if this is really abuse, or, you know, prove to me that this is abuse in some way. And abuse survivors know what's abuse. There's no doubt about it. There's no such thing as provoking abuse. There's no such thing as being too sensitive. When people are calling you names, they're putting you down, they're insulting your intelligence, your abilities, or they're laying their hands on you, that's abuse. And no matter how much you try to sugarcoat it and how much you try to level it down to something that's not abuse, it's still abuse. And one of the main things that I found about people who are very ignorant about the consequences of emotional, verbal, psychological abuse and the extent to which abusers go in order to gaslight you and hide their abuse from the world, and society really supports that victim blaming, is that those people want to focus on, well, what's causing the abuse instead of focusing on the fact that it's the abuser that's causing the abuse. There's literally no other cause. Anybody can be a victim of emotional, psychological abuse as well as physical violence. Anybody. It really has very little to do with a victim's intelligence or strength with regards to when they leave. It really has more to do with the severity of the trauma that they've experienced. Now, I'm sure that you have done your own research on this, but if you've never heard of PTSD, Stockholm Syndrome, trauma bonding, then please do look those up, because those are symptoms that tether victims to their abusers and make them feel incredibly helpless. Again, another term that I, you know, like to use in this when I'm talking about this topic is learned helplessness. A psychologist by the name of Martin Seligman actually did an experiment with dogs where they received so many electric shocks that they, even when they could escape, they didn't. They chose not to because they had developed a sense of learned helplessness. And of course, I know that people are more complex than that. So imagine the dynamic of an abuser and the victim, you have an abuser who's constantly belittling someone, playing a bully, being a bully, really, not even playing one, but being one. There's a very, very evident power dynamic, and a very imbalanced relationship where the abuser has a lot of control. And when you think about whether the victim is under the threat of physical violence, financial dependence, as well as all of the other psychological effects that I just mentioned, you really have to wonder, why are these people in society who are supposed to be your so-called friends focusing more on the provocation, or what provoked this, or is this really abuse, more so than the fact that you were abused by an abuser? Now, I didn't want to get into this whole rant about that, but if you do want to learn more about victim blaming and dismantling some of the stereotypes of abuse survivors, you can check out my blog link, which is in the description below. I've just written a new blog post on that. But I really did want to explain that victim blaming mentality, because that is something that we may experience when we might have certain friends who are not as compassionate or validating as we'd hoped they would be. Now, when we think about childhood abuse, for example, and if we've ever told a friend, you know, I was abused as a child, I can only imagine that a friend who is supportive would tell you, wow, I'm so sorry you went through that. That's horrible. Like, what can I do to help? Whereas if you're an adult survivor of abuse, it seems as if that same compassion is not extended. Now, I'm not saying all people do this. There are certain toxic friends who will do this, who will engage in that victim-blaming mentality and say, oh, why didn't you just leave? As if that kind of agency and that kind of psychological assurance is there when you've been tormented and you've been mistreated so badly. And I want to also make clear that these people don't realize that abusers don't just show up as abusers. In the first few stages of any relationship, abusers really love to hide the fact that they're abusers. Of course, this is one of the main parts of being an emotional predator. You get to groom your victim, you get to love bomb them, and you get to flatter them in your charming demeanor in order to convince them that you're a good person. And throughout the relationship, you'll give them little bits of that that good self, that image, just to keep them on their toes. It's called intermittent reinforcement. Look it up if you don't believe me. And it's a tactic that works. It's a tactic that throws many abuse survivors into a lot of cognitive dissonance. They're of two minds. They're living in a struggle in an internal world where they doubt themselves and the abuse. And given that society tends to doubt them as well, given that their abusers also gaslight them into thinking that, you know, oh, I didn't call you that name, or I didn't curse at you, or I didn't yell at you. You were misreading my tone. You were taking this joke too seriously. You were taking my condescending tone and my horrible joke and my cruel degradation of your abilities as abuse. Oh, it's not abuse. So abusers do that all the time. They gaslight you all the time. And so when we experience invalidation from our own friends who are supposed to be our support network or source of support network, because you can never have too many support networks, we feel that same gaslighting effect. And that actually paradoxically enables us to stay with our abusers even more. Like, we have even more incentive to stay because we feel like nobody's there to support us during this horrific time. And so what I want to remind you is that if you're going through abuse right now, or if you've left an abusive relationship, it's incredibly important for you not to surround yourself with people who are going to invalidate your experience in that manner. People who are going to victim blame you when what you've clearly experienced is abuse. If you've experienced harsh taunting by your abuser, if you've experienced a lot of infidelity, if you've experienced a lot of contempt from your abuser, raising their voice at you, calling you names, insulting your abilities, and you've done absolutely nothing, obviously, to provoke that because you haven't obviously been calling them names. You haven't been belittling them. You haven't been abusing them. So there's literally no excuse for them to abuse you. So if you've been through that experience, you do not want to surround yourself with people who are going to be like, oh, tell me everything about the abuse. Like, tell me in detail, like, what happened before? Like, what? They're going to be questioning you in a way that is very similar to the gaslighting effect that abusers project on you. And that's not very healthy or helpful when you're surviving, when you're trying to thrive after emotional trauma and abuse. So that's one of the major signs when you have a toxic friend is if they're victim blaming, if they call into question your abuse, if they suggest that you provoked it somehow, if they try to call it anything other than abuse. They try to level it down or sugarcoat it so that it doesn't seem as bad as it really is. And they make you feel alone. That's not healthy, that's not helpful, and it's coming from a place of complete ignorance. And it's showing you that this toxic friend does not need to be in your life right now. Now, maybe if later on you want to have a discussion with them about where they're coming from and where you're coming from, that's fine. But right now, during your recovery, you should not be surrounding yourself with people like that. So detach yourself for now, give yourself time and space from these people. And when you've gotten a hold of whether or not you really want them in your life, because honestly, given that they're usually not willing to budge from their stance, I honestly think it comes from a place of deep defense, which can actually hide a lot of actual insecurity. I think that a lot of victim-blaming people are so afraid of what they might actually end up in. They're afraid that if they were ever in an abusive relationship, they wouldn't act the way that they think they would. So when they're the people who are most vocal about, oh, I would have left right away, or I would have done this, or I can't believe you're doing this, actually tend to be the people who've never experienced it themselves. So they've never experienced the pathological mind games, they've never experienced the covert manipulation, they've never experienced the provocation of the deliberate provocation of jealousy through techniques like triangulation. They've never experienced the idealization, devaluation, discard phase. They've never experienced the constant belittling, the demeaning, the degrading behaviors that put you down and make you feel helpless, make you feel worthless. So I don't know if they even know how they would react if they were in an abusive relationship. They might say, oh, I would react this way. However, it's quite impossible to predict one's behavior until you're actually in that situation, especially in the context of an abusive relationship where the power dynamic and the power imbalance is so strong, and you really do feel like you are being traumatized basically by your predator. Now, I'm not trying to take away agency or accountability for victims. I strongly believe in agency and accountability, but I think that a lot of the psychological effects of abuse are hugely underestimated when it comes to talking about emotional abuse, when it comes to talking about victims and society's victim-blaming stance on abuse survivors. So again, I wanna drive home the point that you should not be hanging out with these toxic people during this time. Another thing that I've noticed is that some people can be incredibly condescending about the abuse that you've suffered. So if it's not physical abuse, they don't count it as abuse. Or they might even be sadistic, and they might even derive some sort of sick joy seeing that your relationship didn't work out. And I know that's a very extreme case to mention, but I want to mention it because I've definitely met some sadistic friends who actually take pleasure in the drama of the incident. And those people are most likely narcissists themselves. Those people are most likely abusers themselves in some way, and they're definitely not supposed to be in your friends list, in your life, anywhere near you right now, or ever actually, because those people are the same types of bullies that you are trying to recover from. Now, why do I mention this? You know, it seems like such an extreme example. Like, who would have a sadistic friend like that who would actually be delighted at the fact that you were abused? Well, let me tell you, if you were in a relationship with a narcissistic abuser, it's quite possible that you also have people in your life who are also narcissistic. And so I don't want to get into the whole, do we attract this? Do we invite this in any way? Because that can feed into the victim blaming mentality, and I want to stay away from that. However, I want you to realize that, just like we said, we do have agency, we do have some agency in who we keep in our life. So when you think about it, there are probably traits in the narcissist that you really enjoyed. So think about those traits. It's probably has to do with their charming demeanor, which is a false mask, of course, so they can covertly abuse you. But think about it. You liked that they were gregarious, social, outgoing, fun, charming. You didn't take life so seriously. They didn't take life so seriously, or so you thought until you experienced their rage. All of these traits can also be associated with high levels of narcissism and egocentrism. So if you were also friends with people who are very similar during that time, you might have found those traits attractive in them as well. At first you thought they were great. At first you thought these friends were incredibly outgoing, social, warm, funny, nice. And then you uncovered some of their darker sides, which is actually they're very superficial. They're very egocentric. They're incredibly invalidating, and they're sometimes cruel. So what I want to say is that sometimes we associate with people with similar traits, and this could have to do with a number of things. It could happen to do with our caretakers, our parents, in childhood, and how we interacted with them and our attachment style to them. It could have to do with our own traits. Again, codependency is a very controversial term when it comes to the discourse of abuse survivors, but I do believe that if we don't have codependency before the abuse, we definitely have a sense of it afterwards because we were taught how to be dependent on the abuser's perception of us through that psychological manipulation. So, those types of traits within us could also be somehow compatible with these other darker traits in other people who also are malignant bullies and narcissists. Now, I'm not encouraging you to go around and call everybody in your life a narcissist. That's not helpful. What is helpful is noticing if you do notice these toxic behaviors in other people in your life, because it's very likely that you will find another person in your life who is somewhat of a bully to you. And somewhat, not even somewhat, they could be incredibly toxic, but you may have just realized it because you were starting to research and really think about what it means to be a narcissist and think about abusive tactics and abusive manipulators. Now, before the abuse, you were probably someone who believed in a conscience. You believed that people had consciences. You believed that people had morals, that you could project your own morals onto them, and they would probably have the same morals as you. And after the abuse, you realize that emotional predators, which make up actually a qu like 1 in 25 people, are sociopaths, according to Martha Stout. So it's not very uncommon, as you would think. There are more people out there than we realize who are malignant bullies and narcissists, and they will use these same types of manipulative tactics, these covert manipulative tactics that abusers use to covertly put you down, such as the insulting remark disguised as a joke, or the silent treatment, or emotional withdrawal, or invalidation, or gaslighting. So remember, when your support network is strong, healthy, and nourishing, they are likely to be the opposite of that. They're likely to be warm and positive and safe and nourishing and something that you can really turn to as a safe haven, pun intended. Whereas your toxic friends are very likely to be on the other side of the spectrum, where they're very victim blaming. They're rude, condescending about the abuse. They're dismissive of the abuse. They might even be sadistically pleased when you recount the incidents of abuse, which I don't know if many survivors have experienced that, but I can say that I have, and it's a very disturbing experience when you realize that one of your support network people is actually another malignant bully. And so we really have to pay attention to those cues. We have to learn how to trust our gut again, because the thing that made us really stay in the relationship in the first place was that cognitive dissonance. It was not listening to our intuition. It was not listening to what our emotions were telling us. And our emotions were telling us, this is wrong, this is hurtful, this is scary, this is unsafe, this is not where I want to be. But women, especially, who are taught to not be so emotional and to control their emotions, their hormones, or whatnot, and as a society as a whole, who are told to desensitize yourself and not take things personally, we tend to not take things personally. So we try to see the good in everyone. We try to project our own conscience onto other people. We try to see that everyone has good values and morals. We try to see that everyone is struggling. Everyone is in need of our help, including abusers. And actually, no, let the abusers take care of themselves. It's time for you to take care of yourself. And that includes the toxic friends. So if the toxic friends have never really supported you or been there for you, cut them out of your life. Detach and, well, I don't want to use the word discard, but yeah, discard. Because it's time for you to get a support network that's actually a support network and not another site of psychological violence. So I hope this podcast helped in some way. I hope it validates you. And I hope it's helping you to listen to these podcasts and my videos on YouTube, as well as reading my blog entries and reading my book, perhaps. I hope it's helped you in some way. It's my desire that you learn at this point to really be by yourself and really own your independence and learn how to be feel safe alone, without constantly having to have your friends or anybody else with you, because right now it's a space of healing and recovery that you need, and that can't be done with always depending on someone else to prop you up. And so even though you need that strong support network, you also need yourself during this time, and you need to look within. And so I invite you to meditate, to write, journal, do whatever is healing for you, and take time for yourself to really be alone with you and reconnect to the spirit within you, as well as your instinct and your intuition, which you've ignored for so long, most likely in an abusive relationship. This is the time where you resist the gaslighting from your own mind, and you really start validating the experiences that you just went through. So, wishing you blessings for a new year, and I hope to talk to you soon about your recovery. And if you want to leave any feedback, I'd really appreciate it. I will use your comments to make more videos and podcasts that will be helpful to you as an abuse survivor, as an emotional abuse survivor. And I hope this video helped. And if you did enjoy this video, please consider sharing it with other abuse survivors, or with some of your Facebook friends, which are likely to contain at least one or two people who are like the ones I've just described, and maybe it'll teach them a thing or two. So, happy New Year, and I will talk to you soon. Hey everyone, welcome back to Self Care Haven. You are listening to Emotional Abuse 101, a podcast designed to help survivors stage their own recovery from abuse and also to recognize the covert manipulation tactics that abusers use. Today I'm going to be going a little bit off topic and talking more about toxic friendships. I know we've talked a lot about toxic romantic relationship partners, but friends are very, very important to a survivor's recovery because they serve as a main support network for that survivor. Now, of course, during this time, you should also be seeking alternative support communities with people who've actually been there, who've been through your experience and really know what it's about. And for that, I recommend forums such as Psychopath Free. Let Me Reach by Kim Saeed is a very amazing community, as well as Lisa E. Scott's blog, which also has a forum on narcissistic abuse. But when we think about the people we interact with on a daily basis, a weekly basis, our friends, our close acquaintances, what have you, and their reactions to what we've gone through can really shape our recovery. Of course, we don't have to let it affect us as much, but as a society, we've stigmatized abuse survivors to such an extent that any source of support is really helpful to an abuser's survivor's need for close relationships, need to bond after the abuse, need to feel positively regarded, and their desires to feel validated and supported through one of the hardest times in their life. So if you're surrounding yourself with people who are very invalidating towards your experience, and this could be a number of things that they do. They might engage in victim blaming, where they, instead of focusing on the trauma of the abuse, instead of focusing on what needs to be done for you to heal, they focus more on, well, why didn't you just leave? Or why didn't you leave sooner? Or I don't know if this is really abuse, or prove to me that this is abuse in some way. And abuse survivors know what's abuse. There's no doubt about it. There's no such thing as provoking abuse. There's no such thing as being too sensitive. When people are calling you names, they're putting you down, they're insulting your intelligence, your abilities, or they're laying their hands on you. That's abuse. And no matter how much you try to sugarcoat it and how much you try to level it down to something that's not abuse, it's still abuse. And one of the main things that I found about people who are very ignorant about the consequences of emotional, verbal, psychological abuse and the extent to which abusers go in order to gaslight you and hide their abuse from the world and society really supports that victim blaming, is that those people want to focus on, well, what's causing the abuse instead of focusing on the fact that it's the abuser that's causing the abuse. There's literally no other cause. Anybody can be a victim of emotional, psychological abuse as well as physical violence. Anybody. It really has very little to do with a victim's intelligence or strength with regards to when they leave. It really has more to do with the severity of the trauma that they've experienced. Now, I'm sure that you have done your own research on this, but if you've never heard of PTSD, Stockholm Syndrome, trauma bonding, then please do look those up because those are symptoms that tether victims to their abusers and make them feel incredibly helpless. Again, another term that I, like to use in this when I'm talking about this topic is learned helplessness. A psychologist by the name of Martin Seligman actually did an experiment with dogs where they received so many electric shocks that they even when they could escape, they didn't. They chose not to because they had developed a sense of learned helplessness. And of course, I know that people are more complex than that. So imagine the dynamic of an abuser and the victim. You have an abuser who's constantly belittling someone, playing a bully, being a bully, really, not even playing one, but being one. There's a very, very evident power dynamic, and a very imbalanced relationship where the abuser has a lot of control. And when you think about whether the victim is under the threat of physical violence, financial dependence, as well as all of the other psychological effects that I just mentioned, you really have to wonder, why are these people in society who are supposed to be your so-called friends focusing more on the provocation or what provoked this or is this really abuse more so than the fact that you were abused by an abuser? Now, I didn't want to get into this whole rant about that, but if you do want to learn more about victim blaming and dismantling some of the stereotypes of abuse survivors, you can check out my blog link, which is in the description below. I've just written a new blog post on that. But I really did want to explain that victim blaming mentality because that is something that we may experience when we might have certain friends who are not as compassionate or validating as we'd hoped they would be. Now, when we think about childhood abuse, for example, and if we've ever told a friend, you know, I was abused as a child, I can only imagine that a friend who is supportive would tell you, wow, I'm so sorry you went through that. That's horrible. Like, what can I do to help? Whereas if you're an adult survivor of abuse, it seems as if that same compassion is not extended. Now, I'm not saying all people do this. There are certain toxic friends who will do this, who will engage in that victim blaming mentality and say, oh, why didn't you just leave? As if that kind of agency and that kind of psychological assurance is there when you've been tormented and you've been mistreated so badly. And I want to also make clear that these people don't realize that abusers don't just show up as abusers. In the first few stages of any relationship, abusers really love to hide the fact that they're abusers. Of course, this is one of the main parts of being an emotional predator. You get to groom your victim, you get to love bomb them, and you get to flatter them in your charming demeanor in order to convince them that you're a good person. And throughout the relationship, you'll give them little bits of that good self, that image, just to keep them on their toes. It's called intermittent reinforcement. Look it up if you don't believe me. And it's a tactic that works. It's a tactic that throws many abuse survivors into a lot of cognitive dissonance. They're of two minds. They're living in a struggle in an internal world where they doubt themselves and the abuse. And given that society tends to doubt them as well, given that their abusers also gaslight them into thinking that, you know, oh, I didn't call you that name, or I didn't curse at you, or I didn't yell at you. You were misreading my tone. You were taking this joke too seriously. You were taking my condescending tone and my horrible joke and my cruel degradation of your abilities as abuse. Oh, it's not abuse. So abusers do that all the time. They gaslight you all the time. And so when we experience invalidation from our own friends who are supposed to be our support network or source of support network, because you can never have too many support networks, we feel that same gaslighting effect. And that actually paradoxically enables us to stay with our abusers even more. Like we have even more incentive to stay because we feel like nobody's there to support us during this horrific time. And so what I want to remind you is that if you're going through abuse right now or if you've left an abusive relationship, it's incredibly important for you not to surround yourself with people who are going to invalidate your experience in that manner. People who are going to victim blame you when what you've clearly experienced is abuse. If you've experienced harsh taunting by your abuser, if you've experienced a lot of infidelity, if you've experienced a lot of contempt from your abuser, raising their voice at you, calling you names, insulting your abilities, and you've done absolutely nothing, obviously, to provoke that because you haven't obviously been calling them names, you haven't been belittling them, you haven't been abusing them. So there's literally no excuse for them to abuse you. So if you've been through that experience, you do not want to surround yourself with people who are going to be like, oh, tell me everything about the abuse. Like, tell me in detail, like, what happened before? Like, what? They're going to be questioning you in a way that is very similar to the gaslighting effect that abusers project on you. And that's not very healthy or helpful when you're surviving, when you're trying to thrive after emotional trauma and abuse. So that's one of the major signs when you have a toxic friend is if they're victim blaming, if they call into question your abuse, if they suggest that you provoked it somehow, if they try to call it anything other than abuse. They try to level it down or sugarcoat it so that it doesn't seem as bad as it really is. And they make you feel alone. That's not healthy, that's not helpful, and it's coming from a place of complete ignorance. And it's showing you that this toxic friend does not need to be in your life right now. Now, maybe if later on you want to have a discussion with them about where they're coming from and where you're coming from, that's fine. But right now, during your recovery, you should not be surrounding yourself with people like that. So detach yourself for now, give yourself time and space from these people. And when you've gotten a hold of whether or not you really want them in your life, because honestly, given that they're usually not willing to budge from their stance, I honestly think it comes from a place of deep defense, which can actually hide a lot of actual insecurity. I think that a lot of victim-blaming people are so afraid of what they might actually end up in. They're afraid that if they were ever in an abusive relationship, they wouldn't act the way that they think they would. So when they're the people who are most vocal about, oh, I would have left right away, or I would have done this, or I can't believe you're doing this, actually tend to be the people who've never experienced it themselves. So they've never experienced the pathological mind games, they've never experienced the covert manipulation, they've never experienced the provocation of the deliberate provocation of jealousy through techniques like triangulation. They've never experienced the idealization, devaluation, discard phase. They've never experienced the constant belittling, the demeaning, the degrading behaviors that put you down and make you feel helpless, make you feel worthless. So I don't know if they even know how they would react if they were in an abusive relationship. They might say, oh, I would react this way. However, it's quite impossible to predict one's behavior until you're actually in that situation, especially in the context of an abusive relationship where the power dynamic and the power imbalance is so strong, and you really do feel like you are being traumatized basically by your predator. Now, I'm not trying to take away agency or accountability for victims. I strongly believe in agency and accountability, but I think that a lot of the psychological effects of abuse are hugely underestimated when it comes to talking about emotional abuse, when it comes to talking about victims and society's victim-blaming stance on abuse survivors. So again, I wanna drive home the point that you should not be hanging out with these toxic people during this time. Another thing that I've noticed is that some people can be incredibly condescending about the abuse that you've suffered. So if it's not physical abuse, they don't count it as abuse. Or they might even be sadistic, and they might even derive some sort of sick joy seeing that your relationship didn't work out. And I know that's a very extreme case to mention, but I want to mention it because I've definitely met some sadistic friends who actually take pleasure in the drama of the incident, and those people are most likely narcissists themselves. Those people are most likely abusers themselves in some way, and they're definitely not supposed to be in your friends list, in your life, anywhere near you right now, or ever actually, because those people are the same types of bullies that you are trying to recover from. Now, why do I mention this? You know, it seems like such an extreme example. Like, who would have a sadistic friend like that who would actually be delighted at the fact that you were abused? Well, let me tell you, if you were in a relationship with a narcissistic abuser, it's quite possible that you also have people in your life who are also narcissistic. And so I don't want to get into the whole, do we attract this? Do we invite this in any way? Because that can feed into the victim blaming mentality, and I want to stay away from that. However, I want you to realize that, just like we said, like we do have agency, we do have some agency in who we keep in our life. So when you think about it, there are probably traits in the narcissist that you really enjoyed. So think about those traits. It's probably has to do with their charming demeanor, which is a false mask, of course, so they can covertly abuse you. But think about it. You liked that they were gregarious, social, outgoing, fun, charming. You didn't take life so seriously. They didn't take life so seriously, or so you thought until you experienced their rage. All of these traits can also be associated with high levels of narcissism and egocentrism. So if you were also friends with people who are very similar during that time, you might have found those traits attractive in them as well. At first you thought they were great. At first you thought these friends were incredibly outgoing, social, warm, funny, nice. And then you uncovered some of their darker sides, which is actually they're very superficial, they're very egocentric, they're incredibly invalidating, and they're sometimes cruel. So what I want to say is that sometimes we associate with people with similar traits, and this could have to do with a number of things. It could happen to do with our caretakers, our parents, in childhood, and how we interacted with them and our attachment style to them. It could have to do with our own traits. Again, codependency is a very controversial term when it comes to the discourse of abuse survivors, but I do believe that if we don't have codependency before the abuse, we definitely have a sense of it afterwards, because we were taught how to be dependent on the abuser's perception of us through that psychological manipulation. So those types of traits within us could also be somehow compatible with these other darker traits in other people who also are malignant bullies and narcissists. Now, I'm not encouraging you to go around and call everybody in your life a narcissist. That's not helpful. What is helpful is noticing if you do notice these toxic behaviors in other people in your life, because it's very likely that you will find another person in your life who is somewhat of a bully to you. And somewhat, not even somewhat, they could be incredibly toxic, but you may have just realized it because you were starting to research and really think about what it means to be a narcissist and to think about abusive tactics and abusive manipulators. Now, before the abuse, you were probably someone who believed in a conscience. You believed that people had consciences. You believed that people had morals, that you could project your own morals onto them, and they would probably have the same morals as you. And after the abuse, you realize that emotional predators, which make up actually like 1 in 25 people, are sociopaths, according to Martha Stout. So it's not very uncommon, as you would think. There are more people out there than we realize who are malignant bullies and narcissists, and they will use these same types of manipulative tactics, these covert manipulative tactics that abusers use to covertly put you down, such as the insulting remark disguised as a joke, or the silent treatment, or emotional withdrawal, or invalidation, or gaslighting. So remember, when your support network is strong, healthy, and nourishing, they are likely to be the opposite of that. They're likely to be warm and positive and safe and nourishing and something that you can really turn to as a safe haven, pun intended. Whereas your toxic friends are very likely to be on the other side of the spectrum, where they're very victim blaming, they're rude, condescending about the abuse, they're dismissive of the abuse. They might even be sadistically pleased when you recount the incidents of abuse, which I don't know if many survivors have experienced that, but I can say that I have, and it's a very disturbing experience when you realize that one of your support network people is actually another malignant bully. And so we really have to pay attention to those cues. We have to learn how to trust our gut again, because the thing that made us really stay in the relationship in the first place was that cognitive dissonance. It was not listening to our intuition. It was not listening to what our emotions were telling us. And our emotions were telling us, this is wrong, this is hurtful, this is scary, this is unsafe, this is not where I want to be. But women, especially, who are taught to not be so emotional, and to control their emotions, their hormones, or whatnot, and as a society as a whole, who are told to desensitize yourself and not take things personally, we tend to not take things personally. So we try to see the good in everyone. We try to project our own conscience onto other people. We try to see that everyone has good values and morals. We try to see that everyone is struggling. Everyone is in need of our help, including abusers. And actually, no, let the abusers take care of themselves. It's time for you to take care of yourself. And that includes the toxic friends. So if the toxic friends have never really supported you or been there for you, cut them out of your life. Detach and, well, I don't want to use the word discard, but yeah, discard. Because it's time for you to get a support network that's actually a support network and not another site of psychological violence. So I hope this podcast helped in some way. I hope it validates you. And I hope it's helping you to listen to these podcasts and my videos on YouTube, as well as reading my blog entries and reading my book, perhaps. I hope it's helped you in some way. It's my desire that you learn at this point to really be by yourself and really own your independence and learn how to be feel safe alone, without constantly having to have your friends or anybody else with you, because right now it's a space of healing and recovery that you need, and that can't be done with always depending on someone else to prop you up. And so even though you need that strong support network, you also need yourself during this time, and you need to look within. And so I invite you to meditate, to write, journal, do whatever is healing for you, and take time for yourself to really be alone with you and reconnect to the spirit within you, as well as your instinct and your intuition, which you've ignored for so long, most likely in an abusive relationship. This is the time where you resist the gaslighting from your own mind, and you really start validating the experiences that you just went through. So, wishing you blessings for a new year, and I hope to talk to you soon about your recovery. And if you want to leave any feedback, I'd really appreciate it. I will use your comments to make more videos and podcasts that will be helpful to you as an abuse survivor, as an emotional abuse survivor. And I hope this video helped. And if you did enjoy this video, please consider sharing it with other abuse survivors or with some of your Facebook friends, which are likely to contain at least one or two people who are like the ones I've just described. And maybe it'll teach them a thing or two. So, Happy New Year, and I will talk to you soon.